Welcome back, everybody, to Game 2 of Young Chicken versus Magneto Gaming. It's by far one of the best games that we've had this whole entire Chinese Open qualifiers that we've been doing, whether it's I-League, whether it's MSI Beat It, doesn't seem to matter. This is actually one of the best games so far, so I'm actually excited to be able to get into Game 2. It was fairly, back and forth. It didn't feel totally one-sided, which was a nice change of pace. It was very, very nice change of pace. Now, Young Chicken definitely held the advantage. They definitely held the advantage from the moment that Roshan was taken by that Enigma, and they made that rotation a bottom lane where they caught out two heroes and were able to take that tier one tower. That pretty much secured the advantage that Young Chicken were able to hold on to for the rest of the game. But at least Magneto, like, it felt like they weren't just, like, herp-derping around and had no idea what the hell the Dota game is about. You know, they had a strategy. They executed it. Problem was they didn't count on the Enigma, is all it comes down to. Disruptor. Sorry about that, guys. Early in the morning. Gotta get the frog out of your throat. I need a hot cup of tea is what I need. Shadow Shaman, Tidehunter, Sand King. All going the way of Magneto, Skywrath the Mage, Brewmaster, Ember Spirit, and the Disruptor. All gonna be picked up by Young Chicken. So a lot of team fight here for Young Chicken. Magneto, well, have the same pure team fight heroes right now as they've picked up both their offlaners and their supports. Once again, they're going to go for the Invoker. I mean, there was nothing inherently wrong with their strategy last game. There was nothing really wrong with the Invoker play last game either. So, not going to fault them for picking up here. But they do need to be much more aggressive this time around. Much, much more aggressive, because you're looking at Young Chicken and they've got some... Like, for example, the Disruptor is very good in the mid-game. Brewmaster, exceptionally strong in team fights. Mid-game team fights are wonderful for him. Ember Spirit is going to be the biggest issue, though, because he's quite the late-game hero. He's certainly a hero that has the most scalability, if that's a word. It is now. He's certainly a hero that probably has the most scalability out of all the heroes picked up so far. Invoker does scale into the late game, don't get me wrong, but probably can't compete with the Ember Spirit. If this Invoker can pick up a similar amount of farm that he did last game, though, pick up the Hand of Midas, go for Necrobook 3, start pushing down these towers, get a fast Scythe of Ice after that, I think they've got a really good shot at being able to control the Ember Spirit, make sure he doesn't ball all out. The Clockwork going to be banned away by Magneto, taking away one of the best initiators, but Young Chicken definitely playing a much more late-game oriented strat this time around with the Nature's Prophet. Of course, last time around, they did... I mean, their heroes were more mid-game focused, but you could definitely tell they had the late game between Razor, Lifestealer, the Enigma. So just because they pick up heroes like Ember Spirit, Nature's Prophet... doesn't mean they aren't going to be aggressive in pushing down towers very early on. And making sure, again, Magneto, they probably are going to hit a certain peak, and they want to wait until that peak in order to try and push down these towers. So it may actually be almost the exact same opening, the exact same strategy used here by Young Chicken. You want Necrobook 3 on the Invoker. You'd love to have double Blink Daggers from Tide and Sand King. This time around, hopefully Magneto will do a better job defending their early towers and making sure those pushes aren't successful. Those early rotations aren't as good, because that's really what caught him out guard. The Faceless Void is going to be picked up now, or banned away, by Young Chicken. Taken away on a big hard carry that they don't want to deal with, especially against the Ember Spirit. Ember Spirit is extremely susceptible to the lockdown and physical damage of Faceless Void. He's pretty much one of the ideal counters to an Ember Spirit. And the Lifestealer is going to be the pickup here for Magneto. Can't say I'm too big of a fan. Lifestealer is... it wasn't bad in last game. In last game strats, when Young Chicken picked it up, I want to say it wasn't terrible there. Here, I don't like it nearly as much because ultimately what it comes down to is Lifestealer is now a hero that is melee going up against a lot of mobile heroes. So there's a lot of lockdown on the side of Young Chicken between the Disruptor Kinetic Field. Of course, Rage can get through that as well as the Ultimate. I'm aware of that, but Disruptor is still a good counter. If he can lay down the silence before Lifestealer rages or is able to catch, you know, is able to catch the infested target inside of the Disruptor Ultimate. Now they're both kind of trapped. The kinetic field is always good versus melees. I know Rage can go through it, but at the exact same time, the Rage isn't always up. You've got the Brewmaster, who is going to be blinking in and ulting, so you have no real good lockdown against him as the Lifestealer yourself. So he's hard to kill, and he's probably still going to be able to get off his ultimate all the time. Furion is pretty mobile with his teleport, but he also has Sprout, which is a very good holding ability against many melee carries. And then the Ember Spirit, exceptionally mobile. So I'm a bit concerned that this Lifestealer is going to have a hard time. That being said, he does have plenty of heroes that can set him up for easy kills. Talking about the lack of lockdown, well, Magneto certainly has plenty of heroes that can make up for that. They've got two different melee initiators between both the Sand King and the Tidehunter. So both really, really good infest targets here for the Lifestealer to be able to jump inside. They get a Burrow Strike. He pops out, eats them up before they can do anything. But, you're very much depending on your laning phase going well at that point. You're depending on the Tidehunter to get a Blink Dagger. You're depending on, actually, the Sand King to get a Blink Dagger, too. So you have multiple targets to be able to jump inside, and you're not just waiting for every Ravage to go and get a kill. Furion's going to be farming up the safe lane solo here up against an aggressive tri lane of Shadow Shaman, Sand King, as well as the Lifestealer. That leaves our Tidehunter in the safe lane where he's facing up against an aggressive dual lane from the Brewmaster and Disruptor. Skywrath Mage will also be joining him. He was just sitting at the top rune. Mid matchup is going to be the Ember Spirit versus the Invoker, which is already favorable for the Ember Spirit due to a rather strong block by him. So he actually has the creep advantage so far. This lane certainly does cost him a lot of HP points. He's going to be going for a quick bottle, so that's going to help him out quite a bit. Bottom lane looks like they're already going for the dive. Well played by the Furion, though. Saw what he was doing, keeping the treants behind him. And it's actually the top lane where they're able to get the kill on the Tidehunter, thanks to the double damage of the Skywrath Mage. It looks like they slowed him down and were able to Thunderstrike him. Get enough right clicks. But yeah, the Furion using the Nature's Call, the treants to be able to follow him into that clutch area and make sure the Lifestealer had a hard time getting around those creeps and getting those right clicks in. So Tidehunter's probably, well, it looks like he's going to be stacking up jungle a bit. I don't think this lane is so dangerous. Especially safe lane solo like this. If he was in his off lane against this defensive tri lane, I could totally get that. Like, okay, it's very, very dangerous. But I would feel that the safe lane solo should work out for the Tidehunter. And he shouldn't necessarily need to be moving around, stacking, and doing things like that. Well, this is awkward. That ward does completely reveal the Skywrath Mage. What Invoker may not realize is that the Disruptor is also there. Smoke is going to pop soon, though. And finally, it looks like the Radiant realize that they've been spotted out. They know what's going on. Furion sitting very, very far back. In fact, he's even going to teleport up to the top lane. They're going to get a surprise gank, it looks like, on the Tidehunter or not. There we go. Now they start eating through the trees. Now trying to get to him, but the gank has already been completely spoiled. It should have been like a pickoff on the Tidehunter turned into a tier 1 tower. Looks like instead they're just going to go for the tier 1 tower. As every single time they pull the lane back, Furion can't really move forward, so might as well put some pressure on the other lanes. Makes a lot of sense. Dire's top tower. Smoke Gank going to be coming in from the Shadow Shaman and the Sand King onto the mid lane Ember Spirit. Pull roots and run. Seeing if they could pick him off. It's tough for Sand King to be able to get in range of people most of the time, but extra bit of smoke movement speed. That was a bit of an overextension there from Mars. He might have just fed information to Joyce that there's no reason the Evoker would be diving that aggressively unless he had a plan. And that plan is probably the two supports coming in. That's why Joyce is sitting on the side here just soaking up the experience, not trying to get too close. Supports are just wait. There's nobody here in the bottom lane. It's not like they need to be here. Tier 1 tower at the top lane has already gone down thanks to the Furion push. Now he's going to get himself back in the lane. Now they try and come out, but the Sand King just nowhere close enough in range. Think Magneto are realizing, like, hey, Young Chicken, this is what they did to us last game. We need to make sure that we either get towers in return early on. Unfortunately, that is going to be a bit of a return kill. Double kill, actually. And Marcy is going to be going down. This is why Ember Spirit, the Flame Guard, it's why it's such a strong hero. It's why so many Ember Spirits are going for 204 or even 404 build. The Flame Guard makes him so damn tanky and a ton of damage over time. The best use of Flame Guard is when you have this 500 magic absorption and they do like 400 magic damage to you, so you take no damage, but you'd still just enough to keep your Flame Guard intact and still doing the damage over time. Buren's gonna teleporting in. Looks like they're gonna content themselves with the Shadow Shaman kill with a clap and a right click. Pretty damn easy. Tidehunter comes in, he's anchor smashed them up, but this is now the Sand King. Actually has a double damage rune, so he's gonna be able to get the kill on the Furion, which is a good trade for sure, but it cost actually a full 5-man rotation. Even Marcy was coming over. So heavy commitment here from Magneto, but that's kind of what they had to do. When Young Chicken are willing to group up so early, get ganks, push down towers, you have to respond accordingly. You just can't afford to sit back and let you just sit there and smoke. Marcy going to be dove on, but with that ice path in the way, there's no way. Ice wall, rather. And Nori comes in from the side, able to finish off Marcy with another right click. Well done. And even puts a nice little aggressive ward behind the tower, which is going to be able to feed him information into those kind of rotations. Skywrath Mage may be able to get another pickoff like that because of that ward, but also give the Ember Spirit notice and when they try and come forward and set up a gank on him. Rotation behind the bottom lane now. Shadow Shaman going to be caught again now, as he's just bouncing from lane to lane and dying and dying and dying. And now another tier 1 tower again. I don't know, Magneto, if they just don't know how to respond to this or what it is, but they're very rapidly losing ground to Young Chicken once again. Oh, good pickoff there on the Tidehunter in the top lane. Ember Spirit rotates over. Bottom lane, though, looks like they're going to be able to get the Lifestealer, who is trying to silence, rage, and infest just in time. They're actually going to bring the creeps back, but this is good. YSOI actually wants to keep on going. Nice two-man Burrow Strike. They're going to be able to finish off at least one hero. It's going to be Inori as Sunstrike comes in, finish them off. YSOI has to back himself up. Believe trying to commit to getting those last couple right clicks, but it's not going to be enough. And now the Sand King comes forward, misses the Burrow Strike. And that's going to allow the Disruptor to be able to walk away. Sandstorm goes up. Marcy now comes in with his extra bit of movement speed that he has from Phase Boots. And beautiful blocking Sprout gives them enough time to be able to teleport away. That was a very, very pretty Sprout. Joyce Chu now coming in with his Flame Guard maxed out. He's taking a bit of magic damage, but the turnaround. Oh, Brewmaster jumps in, hits the clap, surrounds the Invoker with his ultimate. And still, Joyce is able to pick off the Tidehunter and walk himself away from that engagement. 9-2, and this feels like a much, much more one-sided match than we saw in game one. As Magneto, I mean, they have a mid-game lineup. They have a mid-game lineup, and you're losing the laning phase. That early blink dagger for the Brewmaster. Blink and arcanes. Also finds himself a regen rune. Again, they're going to see the rotations coming in here. Sand King teleports, they see that. And they see the heroes coming in, but they're not going to be here in time. They knew they'd be able to clip the tower. Oh, Brewmaster. He's going for it. He's going for it. No ultimate, but he's still going to be able to hit a two-man clap. Joyce commits to taking down one of the supports. Does so successfully. Diving underneath the tier 2 tower pretty heavily here. The Flame Guard is still protecting him quite a bit. But the physical damage threatening him, he's going to be forced back. Sand King's going to be trapped inside the Sprout, taken out. Lifestealer comes in, but does he really have enough movement speed? Another clap, focusing on the Tidehunter. Anchor Smash limits its damage, and oh, just barely does the Disruptor get away. And what a block! Believe, using the Treants to surround the Invoker like that one, takes him down in the process. Nature's Prophet's going to be forced to teleport away. Tidehunter finally does die as the Brewmaster comes in for a third clap on him, and now sticks around for maybe a fourth one. He's going to see, oh, nice. Two-man clap, turned around, raged up. They're going to focus on the Brewmaster. His evasion not doing him quite enough. And the Infest. Instead of immediately popping it, he could have had the chance to pop the Brewmaster. He's going to wait for a time. A Furion. Does he realize this? He's bringing it back intentionally. I don't know if he's baiting himself intentionally, but the Lifestealer, he does have mana for rage. He should be able to rage TP, I think. Infest, Rage TP. I thought any moment there the Lifestealer was going to pop out and actually consume the Nature's Prophet. Look at what they're doing. They're setting up this whole entire gank. Now he's going to pop out. Rage, teleport, teleport. Oh, he didn't do it in time. He's going to get right click down. Especially with that big critical of the Brewmaster. He had to pop out so much sooner than that. He had to either commit to killing that Furion, in which case he would probably die, but at least he would get for a one for one, or pop out much sooner than what he did. I'm not sure. I didn't actually look at his teleport early on, but I really thought he could commit to getting a Lifestealer kill there, or a Furion kill. Either way, though, Young Chicken definitely... I can't believe that Furion was so manly, though. Just bringing the Treant along, sitting below half health, and he just brings the pet Treant along with the Lifestealer infested inside. No problem. It's like, I ain't scared. Do what you want. Kill me or don't. Either way, you're going to die. Tier 2 is going to fall now here in this bottom lane. Ravage goes off, catches out 3, which isn't bad. They're going to focus on Inori. Inori still guns off its ultimate, which is pretty damn good. Sand King going to be silenced up and taken down immediately. Joyce, meanwhile, oh, what a beautiful chains into his ultimate. Remnant's doing a huge amount of damage. Even the Meteor comes in, and unfortunately, that's going to spell the end of Lifestealer. Joyce, well, they even throw out the Disruptor ultimate. He just picked up level 6. And GG called 11-minute GG. That's the Chinese amateur Dota that we know and love. 11-minute GG calls. So, Young Chicken, yeah, looking good. I mean, Magneto stomped the team that they faced up against. Young Chicken just stomped Magneto. We're climbing the echelons of skill here. Bit by bit, climbing the echelons. All right, guys, so we are going to be having a bit of a break. That is a best of three that goes the way of Young Chicken 2-0. We will be having a break now. I'm not sure how long. I'm going to be talking to the admins. I don't know if we're going to be jumping into another best of three or if we have another 2.5-hour break. Please, God, no. But we'll see. So I'll get back to you guys as soon as possible.